7, 8, 2, 3. Session 26. Of English. The social physics of English. You have already written the course description. Can you go over what you have written? Let's see one
for you. The class exposes students to the concept of relationship between language and society. E.g., the international creation and usage.
So, go on and understand what's happening. And the first one is what is there? And the second one is
materializes
and materializes. The third one is code mixing and code switching. Code mixing and switching. And then the fourth one is language contact and language competence. Language contact and language competence. The next one is language policy. Language policy. The next one is pidgin and clue. Pidgin and clue. We can also put in brackets pidginization and cluelization. Pidginization and globalization. The next one is register and slang. Register and what? Slang. The next one is refusal strategies. Refusal strategies. Politeness strategies. Politeness strategies. Politeness strategies. Refusal strategies and politeness strategies. Okay. So can you go back to your second? Number one. Three.
Four. Language contact and language competence.
Five.
Language policy.
Six.
Pidgin and clue.
Bracket.
Pidginization and pluralization.
And then.
Register and slang.
And then.
Future strategies.
And then.
Politeness strategies.
So, that was it. Our working formula in this course, this semester, what we call course outline. But let me remind you that we have done courses that will not make this course to be completely strange to you. Yes or no?
Yes.
For instance, you have done a course called Language and Society. For instance, you have done a course called Introduction to Language, under which we introduce you to sociolinguistics. Am I right?
Yes.
Okay. So, in other words, this course is not a completely new course to you, but it does build on what you had already known before now in the course. Maybe some of the things we didn't discuss in detail before, we may now want to discuss them in detail. Okay? What I've intentionally left out here are the factors of age, the factors of sex, and then the factor of what?
Class.
Of what? Of class. God bless you. Amen. Give yourself a round of applause. I'll give her a round of applause now. So, three things that I've left out. What are they? Class. Why did I leave them out? Because I expected you to still remember them. Coming from the knowledge of the other courses you have done. Remember we said the factor of age affects language and interaction. For instance, if you are, if a small child is interacting with an adult in terms of language, there are certain limitations that you accept, and there are certain limits that you expect from that particular child. Yes or no?
Yes.
So, in other words, age affects language and language use. Am I right? As a matter of fact, we talk about children's acquisition of language. You don't expect the kind of maturity you find in adults' speech and adults' usage of language to also occur in children's use of language. Am I right? So meaning that age is a factor of interaction. Okay? Then sex is also a factor of interaction in language. Sex, not in terms of how many times a year, but in terms of whether it's a man or a woman. Whether it's a man or a woman. Okay? Well, in talking about sex and language, the gap is now widened. Before, there used to be two choices before. If you say sex, what are you talking about? Man or woman? Am I right? Male or female? But, you know, with the new trends we have in the world now, it has changed. The factor of sex is not restricted to man or woman again. And you know it. Because you have man, you have woman, or you have male, you have female. You also have what? Transgender. So in other words, Abigail may say, look, I don't want to be a woman again. And Nabla may say, look, my wife is Muna. And then you begin to wonder, but Muna is a woman, and Nabla that is saying that Muna is my wife is also a woman. But in that kind of arrangement, it means that Nabla is saying that, look, biologically speaking, I may be a woman, but I don't know why you're shaking your head. Biologically speaking, I may be a woman, but in terms of purposeful gender, I have decided to be a man. And then I have an interaction, I have a relationship with another person whom I have regarded as my wife. So all these have implications for what? For language. They have implications for language study. They also have implications for how language is used in society. I've told you the story before of a place where I was in the US, and I stepped on somebody, and somebody complained that I have stepped on his wife. And I looked around, and I did not see anyone around us. And I was confused. My wife, but there's no woman. And then the person saw that I was bemused, and he pointed to the person whom he regarded as a wife. And behold, that person, in my mind, I thought was a man too. Was a man too. But the man said, that is his wife. Why? Because he said it's his wife, I quickly thought fast. Okay, is it what I was reading about? So it is really happening. And I apologized. So meaning that in that society, I was almost confused because I thought that a wife is restricted to a woman. But the reality now confronted me that no, a wife can go beyond a woman. And then here we are, language has affected it. So the traditional way of looking at language in terms of sex has been widened. You know, these days now, even the Bible, it has affected the Bible. There's a group, it will surprise you if you Google a gender activist of the Bible. Gender activist of the Bible, it will surprise you that there is a group of people now that are protesting about certain references to God in the Bible. The use of he to refer to God has been contested. Seriously. Some people are saying, why are you using he to describe God? That does make it gender free. Gender free. Is that why you repeat God? God will provide for you. God will make a way for you where there's no way. Instead of saying he will do, he will say no. Keep on saying God. And if you must put a pronoun there, say she. Say, why can God be he and not a she? Is it not the God of man and the God of woman? Fantastic arguments all over the place. But for us in language studies, it has implication that language cannot be used ordinarily again. In those days, we just ask people, what is your sex? Male, female, two choices you are expecting. But these days, it goes beyond two choices. Two choices. Now, what is sociolinguistics? Based on your previous understanding, based on your previous knowledge, what is sociolinguistics? Aladdin.
Has to do with the study of language, the relationship to it is used in our society.
The use of language in the society. Use of language in the society. Abigail, can you build on that particular definition? What is social justice?
Because a society is said to be come together of two or more who are bound by defined geographical territory. And as such, for them to communicate and interact with one another, they have to communicate using language. And language stands as one of the most important factors in an existing society.
Okay, thank you. So, social linguistics, in addition to what the two of them have said, is the study of language in social context. The study of language in where?
Social
context. But the question now may be asked, what is the social context? What is the social context? Muna, what is your idea of social context? Just give me an example of a social context.
Market.
God bless you. The marketplace, the use of language in the marketplace. I want you to pay attention to this very first because 90% of those of students who study language, English language, they get their essay, long essay, project, topics from this course. Somebody may want to say, let me study the language of the market way. That's social context. I've told you before that I have an article which I call Carigo, the language of the bus conductors in Lagos. That is social context. I'm sure you are familiar with the language of bus conductors. You know, you are not in public school. Those in public school, they enter, they are with the board mode where they board the board this thing. You don't go by commercial transport. You have experience outside school.
Yes.
For instance, you know, they have their own way of referring to denominations. They don't say 1 naira, 2 naira, 10 naira, 20 naira, 550 naira. If you follow public transportation in Lagos, for instance, and they measure money and you are new to the system, you'll be confused. Say, what do you want for Waso? You gave me. Say, what is Waso? I gave you Waso. Who gave you Waso? What are you talking about? What gibberish are you talking about? Waso? What is Waso? Whereas what is referring to is what? 50 naira. And 20 naira is regarded as what? It's not for one. 20 naira is shandy. 10 naira is fiber. You know, that's how they give names, and that's language. Language in social context. Well, did I give you slang as part of what was it? When you get to a slang, you see, even among students, you have their own particular language. I don't know whether you have developed your own idiom, peculiar idiom in MTU, but there is no social group that will be together and will not have the language that is peculiar to them. Yeah. You must have language that is peculiar to you. So when somebody now begins to study that particular language that is peculiar to you, you are being language in social context. The context, you have defined it. You have defined it. And you know, at the North of Lagos, they have their own way of referring to certain things, certain experiences around them. You know, for instance, you have people, you don't have squatters here in MTU, but over there, you have squatters. Somebody will legitimately get a space officially. But that person that has got the space is not the only person that will stay in the space. Are you aware of that?
Yes, sir.
And sometimes he may have more than three or four people that are managing that place with him or her. That person, if it's a woman, is the landlady. If it's a man, it's what? A landlord. So it is not unlikely for you to come across a student in class saying that, I have to go to cafeteria. I want to go and meet my landlady. You'll be wondering, landlady, okay, I am down. Say, no, it is not referring to town. She's referring to the landlady on campus. That is the person that has legitimately got that accommodation. Right? And when that one will talk to you, that one will refer to my tenant. My tenant, because he's a tenant, he's a student, in fact, they will be in the same class. But that one becomes a tenant. Okay? Then, if he doesn't call him a tenant, he calls him what? A squatter. And when the squatter has brought in another squatter, then he becomes squatter raised to the power of two. Squatter to the second degree. And when someone, you know, you have double bunk, you have the one down and then the one up. The one down, no problem. But the one up, somebody, your friend can ask you, are you a field officer or a lieutenant colonel? Or a flight lieutenant. If I fly lieutenant, it means that you are staying on top because you have to be flying. You have to be flying to get to the top of the place. So this is language in social context. There's also language in the classroom. The teacher interacting with the students. That's language in social context. There's a way a lecture will start. There's a way a teacher enlists response from the students. There's a way the teacher wants to find out whether the students are following or not. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Can you see? That is one way. Are you following me?
Yes, sir.
To where? Only God knows. is also language in social context, formal context, you may say. You have the language of politics, where the politicians will go and then campaign. You have the language of governance, you have official language, and the rest of them. All these are what we shall be looking at in this course. And as you go along, God will give you the wisdom and knowledge to comprehend it, so that your contents can be excellent. In Jesus' name.